what a rogue and peasant slave am I? Is it not monstrous that this player here, but in a fiction, in a dream of passion, could force his soul so to his own conceit that from her working all his visage wanned, tears in his eyes, distraction in his aspect, a broken voice, and his whole function suiting with forms to his conceit, and all for nothing, for Hecuba. What's Hecuba to him or he to Hecuba that he should weep for her? What would he do? Had he the motive and the cue for passion that I have, he would drown the stage with tears and cleave the general ear with horrid speech, make mad the guilty and appall the free. Yet I, a dull and muddy mettled rascal, peak like John o' Dreams, unpregnant of my cause, and can say nothing. No, not for a king, upon whose property and most dear life a damned defeat was made. Am I a coward? For it cannot be that I am pigeon-livered and lack gall to make oppression bitter, or ere this I would have fatted all the region kites with this slave's offal. Bloody, bawdy villain, remorseless, treacherous, lecherous, kindless villain, the vengeance! Why, what an ass am I? This is most brave, that I, the son of a dear father murdered, prompted to my revenge by heaven and hell, must like a whore unpack my heart with words and fall a-cursing like a very drab, a scullion. Ah, about my brain. I have heard that guilty creatures sitting at a play have by the very cunning of the scene been struck so to the soul that presently they have proclaimed their malefactions. For murder, though it have no tongue, will speak with most miraculous organ. I'll have these players play something like the murder of my father before mine uncle. I'll observe his looks. I'll tent him to the quick. If he but blench, I know my course. The spirit that I have seen may be the devil, and the devil hath power to assume a pleasing shape. Yea, and perhaps out of my weakness and my melancholy, as he is very potent with such spirits, abuses me to damn me. I'll have grounds more relative than this. The play. The play's the thing wherein I'll catch the conscience of the king.
Edward will use women honorably.
Ah,
would he were wasted, marrow, bones, and all, that from his loins no hopeful branch may spring to cross me from the golden time I look for. And yet between my soul's desire and me is Clarence, Henry, and his young son Edward, and all the unlooked-for issue of their bodies, to take their rooms ere I can place myself. Well, say there is no kingdom then for Richard. What other pleasure can the world afford? I'll make my heaven in a lady's lap, and deck my body in gay ornaments, and witch sweet ladies with my words and looks. Ah, miserable thought, and more unlikely than to accomplish 20 golden crowns. Why, love forswore me in my mother's womb, and for I should not deal in our soft laws, she did corrupt frail nature with some bribe to shrink mine arm up like a withered shrub, to put an envious mountain on my back where sits deformity, to mock my body, to shape my legs of an unequal size, to disproportion me in every part like to a chaos or an unlicked bear whelp that carries no impression like the dam. And am I then a man to be beloved? Oh, monstrous thought to harbor such a thought. Well, then since this earth affords no joy to me, but to command, to check, and to o'erbear such as are of better person than myself, I'll make my heaven to dream upon the crown, and to account this world but hell, until this misshaped trunk that bears this head be round impaled with a glorious crown. And from this torment I will free myself, or hew my way out with a bloody axe. Why, I can smile and murder whiles I smile, and wet my cheeks with artificial tears, and cry content to that which grieves my heart, and frame my face to all occasions. Can I do this and cannot get a crown? Tut! Were it further off, I'll pluck it down.